On today's episode, we're getting started with the construction of a couple of cabinets for a laundry room. Not ours, of course. Never, never happens. I hear about it all the time.
Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Sponsored by
Microjig, maker of the Gripper. Work safer, work smarter.
And by Centipede Tool, manufacturer of the Centipede Portable Work System, the ultimate in portable work support. For more information, visit centipedetool.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. So on today's episode, like I mentioned in the beginning, we are getting started on the construction of these cabinets. Now, these are just some basic run-of-the-mill cabinets. They'll end up having two doors for each one of these cabinets, and we can see this in the SketchUp drawing. Really, when it comes down to it, it's a rather straightforward project. So what we're going to do is actually we're going to break it into two episodes, and today we're going to concentrate on the construction of the boxes themselves, and then we'll come back in and concentrate on the construction of the face frame and the doors. So with the construction of the boxes, what we're using is half-inch birch plywood. In fact, this is Baltic birch plywood. We used this in a previous project. I had some scraps left over, so this worked out really, really well for us. We got a really nice show face on the interior, and the outside, while still looking pretty good, is actually, it's a little bit of the rougher grade, but the nice thing about that is when these are in position, we're not really going to notice that at all. And on top of it, these are going to be painted, so that really kind of helps quite a bit. At least they're going to be painted on the outside. As of right now, I'm toying with the idea of leaving them the natural color and maybe putting like shellac or something on the interior just to give it some sort of coating, but not really too worried about it. We'll get more into that later on. With the construction of the boxes themselves, it's very, very straightforward. And perhaps the hardest part I had coming up with the design was trying to decide what joinery was I going to use to create the boxes themselves. Originally, I was thinking I would just do straight up butt joints and have the boxes assembled together using just biscuit joinery. It would work out really, really well because of adding the face frame. It would help to add some rigidity to it. That would make it very easy, especially when it comes to ripping and cross-cutting the pieces. But I decided, you know what, even though the face frame is going to hide the box, I went ahead and I opted to go with something that I think is going to add a lot of strength to the box, a lot more than maybe the biscuits, even though I really don't feel like I will need it once I get everything assembled. But I went with what's called a blind rabbet joint. Let's go ahead and get started on the actual construction of the blind rabbet, because it's really, really simple. We'll come in here, we'll get a closer look at this and talk about the mating pieces for the blind rabbet. This is actually a combination of two types of joints. There's a dado, and then there's a matching rabbet that fits into the dado. And where it really has a lot of strength is the fact that these mating pieces really help to kind of support each other, and they complement one another. When we have that rabbet, it's using its shoulder right here to help hold everything in place and keep it square. In fact, when we did a dry fit for this, what we ended up doing was we, of course, had no glue in it because it was a dry fit, but once we had the joint in position, it actually held itself up. I didn't need any type of clamps or special jigs or anything to get it nice and square. It squared itself up with this combination of the rabbet and the dado. Now, another really big thing about using this type of joinery is that combination of the rabbet and the dado also creates a lot of surface space to apply glue, and that is, of course, going to help give us a lot more adhesion so that it's going to stay together. Of course, it also means that you can use a little bit too much glue and you have squeeze out all over the place, and I have a couple places here where I need to clean it up, but really it is super strong, and on top of it, it's actually pretty easy to make. So let's go ahead and take a look at how we did that. Creating the blind rabbet joint is really simple, and I'm going to do all of my joinery using the table saw with a stacked dado head cutter. You could easily accomplish the same things we're going to demonstrate using a router and, say, a straight cutting bit or a spiral bit or maybe even a rabbeting bit for the rabbet joint. But really, it's you could use one or the other, but I really like using my stacked dado head cutter for this type of work. I feel like I get a lot more control and I get a much more accurate results. At least that's my own, myself. That's the way I feel about it. But anyways, I want to go ahead and get started first by cutting these dados in the side. And this was really simple. I just measured down about a half an inch, and then I set up my rip fence so that it would match exactly where I wanted this to start. One thing I'm going to do, kind of a quick aside here, remember when working with plywood, most plywoods are not the thickness that they indicate. So in this case, I'm working with half-inch thick plywood. It's coming in probably about a 32nd of an inch under that half an inch. So I was thinking about that when I went ahead and struck the line for, or measured for where this dado is going to start. In this case, it's a little bit okay if it's proud. In fact, you can kind of see in this picture that it is a little proud, because once we get that face frame in place, you're not really going to notice it. But if you want to make sure that your top and your bottom are flush perfectly with the sides, that's something to think about. Or once it's done, just come back in and remove that material. But anyways, though, let's go ahead and move on with this. So we get that stacked dado head cutter in place. We've got the fence all set up, and we now start to make our first pass, making sure to put pressure as close to the over the top of the stacked dado head cutter as possible. Probably should have been using some sort of push stick jig here, but anyway, so that helps to make sure that we get a nice dado all the way across. And of course, we flip the piece over, and we've done it on the other end, making sure that they're both on the same exact face. So now that we have the sides all taken care of, we now need to turn our attention to the top and the bottom, and this is where we're going to create this rabbet. Now for the rabbet, again, we're not doing anything much different. We're going to use the same stacked dado head cutter for the same thickness. The only difference is that we need to make sure that we've got it for the right height. Again, remember, I just said a second ago that the thickness is not what they indicate. It is actually just under. But for this rabbet, I want to make sure that the tongue is a quarter of an inch so that it will fit in that dado perfectly. So the waste material that I'm removing is not a quarter of an inch. I'm going to remove just a little bit less than that. My emphasis is to make sure that the thickness of that tongue for the rabbet itself is a quarter of an inch. So I did a couple of passes to make sure that I got it to the right thickness. And once I was spot on with it, we went ahead and moved forward with cutting the rabbets on either end, again, concentrating on the right face so that we've got the nice show face on the interior. And as you can see, the setup is exactly the same. The only difference is we brought the rip fence forward just a little bit closer to the blade, and we put a sacrificial fence so that we could run it right up against the edge and get a nice clean cut. So now that the dado and the rabbets are all taken care of, I do a quick dry run to see where things are going to stick and how it's going. And like I mentioned previously, the beauty of this joint is the fact that it actually, it's self-supporting. It brought itself together and it was pretty much squared right from the get-go. There was very little that I had to worry about. So when it came to applying the glue, the first thing I did was I had the sides, and I applied some glue in the dado, and then I also worked it on that one shoulder. I just kind of put just enough on there to make sure that it's nice and tacky. I brought the first top in, and I started to fit it in place. And as always tends to happen a little bit, I want to make sure that it's really, really snug so we get a nice closed joint here, and it helps, again, to help support itself. So we need a little persuasion to get it to fit into position. But thankfully, it went together rather nice, and I didn't worry. One thing I was concerned about is breaking off this little ledge here for the dado, but we were able to get it in just the right way with that little bit of persuasion. Once we have the first top in place, we're going to go ahead and apply the bottom. And again, we're just going to repeat it by applying the glue on the dado, put a little bit on the shoulder, and then kind of persuade it into position. Once that's taken care of, we just kind of flip it over, and then we go ahead and attach the other side. To clamp it in position, you know, I could just come in with some regular bar clamps and hold it together. And again, that shoulder is really, really giving it that squareness, that rigidity. But I decided to go with the web clamps. I just really like using those web clamps because it helps to make sure that everything stays nice and square. So I apply those with a little, I had a couple moments there where I couldn't get the corner braces in position. But once I did, we were able to move forward with it. I then applied a clamp here on this one because I noticed right in the center it was a little gappy, so I applied the clamp just to help pull them together. Once that was done, I did the same on the second one and set them aside to glue up, and then came over to start working on this piece right here, which when this gets put in position in that laundry room, this is what we will attach it to the wall with. And more or less, I really didn't shoot any footage for this because it was just a matter of just ripping it to the length or the width that we needed, and then cross cutting it to the length, which comes in here about, it's about, originally it was supposed to be 29 inches, but thankfully we do a little bit of relative dimensioning, so I double checked once I had this assembled and found that it was actually more like 28 and 15 sixteenths. So we went ahead and measured for that, and now let's see how we attached it in the back. So as you can see, we just used some pocket hole joinery for these. I know some of you are grimacing at that, but it works really well, and I'm pretty happy with it because on top of it, nobody's going to ever see these, and it's going to stay right in position once we get this up against the wall. So as you can see, we just broke out our Craig jig and drilled for the holes at either end. And then once those were taken care of, we came back in and we clamped it tight against the side here using one of the Craig specialty clamps. And it was just a matter of clamping one end and then of course screwing in the adjacent piece and then working our way across to both sides doing the top and the bottom. And once we had that taken care of, we're pretty much done. All right, folks, and that's all there really is to the construction of these rather basic boxes. The most difficult thing is the blind rabbet joints, but as you can see, it's just a dado and a rabbet. I don't think I can say that anymore. A dado and a rabbet, and they come together and make a really super strong joint, and I'm very happy with this, deciding to go this route. It was a lot of fun also. In the next episode, we'll get started on creating that face frame and probably wrap it up with the doors and everything, and that way it'll be all set to go, as you can see in the SketchUp drawing, what it looks like. And if I haven't mentioned it already or emphasized enough, we're going to be painting this whole entire project. So the nice thing about that is that it will hide any imperfections. And once we get it in place, it's going to look absolutely gorgeous. No guarantee that I'll be doing any of the finishing stuff here in the episodes. Again, it's just simply painting it. But if you have comments, questions, suggestions, you know how to get a hold of me. You can email me at mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Of course, you can leave a comment in the show notes over at the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com. And if you're watching this over at YouTube or wherever else, you can leave a comment over there. I love hearing from all of you. So until the next time, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.
Thanks for watching. For more information on topics discussed in this episode, visit mattsbasementworkshop.com.